Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Taxes in America, What Everyone Needs to Know, Second Edition, by Leonard E. Burman and Joel Slemrod. Narrated by Jim Seybert. Publisher's Note: This audiobook refers to figures and tables included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Preface. Who are we? Leonard E. Burman is the Paul Volcker Professor of Behavioral Economics and Professor of Public Administration and International Affairs at the Maxwell School of Syracuse University, an Institute Fellow at the Urban Institute. He co-founded the Tax Policy Center, TPC, a nonpartisan joint venture of the Urban Institute and the Brookings Institution. The TPC is widely respected in Washington policy circles for the quality, objectivity, and clarity of its analysis of complex subjects. Burman previously served as Deputy Assistant Secretary for Tax Analysis at the Treasury Department and Senior Economist at the Congressional Budget Office. He was President of the National Tax Association, NTA, the leading American organization of experts in the theory and practice of taxation, from 2010 to 2011, and received the NTA's Davy Davis Award for Public Service in 2016. He often testifies before Congress on tax and budget policy issues, and his commentaries have been published in top newspapers and aired on public radio. He is the author of the book The Labyrinth of Capital Gains Tax Policy, A Guide for the Perplexed. Joel Slemrod is the Paul W. McCracken Collegiate Professor of Business Economics and Public Policy at the Stephen M. Ross School of Business and professor in the Department of Economics at the University of Michigan. He also serves as the director of the Office of Tax Policy Research, an interdisciplinary research center housed at the Ross School of Business. He has served as the senior economist for tax policy at the President's Council of Economic Advisors, has been a member of the Congressional Budget Office Panel of Economic Advisors, and has testified before Congress on domestic and international taxation issues. From 1992 to 1998, Slemrod was editor of the National Tax Journal, and from 2006 to 2010 was a co-editor of the Journal of Public Economics. From 2005 to 2006, he was president of the National Tax Association. He is co-author with John Bakija of Taxing Ourselves, A Citizen's Guide to the Debate Over Taxes, whose fifth edition was published in 2017. In 2012, he received the prestigious Daniel M. Holland Medal from the National Tax Association for distinguished lifetime contributions to the study and practice of public finance. Why did we team up to write this book? Mostly because we're old friends and like working together. We go way back. Indeed, Len was Joel's first PhD student when we both were at the University of Minnesota. Since then, we have kept in touch through the ups and downs of tax policy and have shared a commitment to educating the public about sometimes opaque tax issues, even while acknowledging that we don't have all the answers and sometimes even have differing views. Once before, we took a shot at something like this, co-authoring in 2003 an article for the Milken Institute Review titled My Weekend with Nick and Adam, Tax Policy and Other Willful Misunderstandings. Some traces of that article, available at www.urban.org/uploaded PDF/100554.pdf, survive in this book. Slemrod has co-authored a book, Taxing Ourselves, with former University of Michigan PhD student John Bakija, who is professor of economics at Williams College. That book is used in many undergraduate and master's level classes on public finance and taxation. We highly recommend it to readers who want to delve more deeply into tax policy. After talking for years about doing this, we finally did it, publishing the first edition of this book in 2013. What's the book about? Taxes have always been an incendiary topic in the United States. A tax revolt launched the nation, and the modern-day Tea Party invoked the mantle of the early revolutionaries to support the call for low taxes and limited government. And yet, despite the passion and fury, most Americans are remarkably clueless about how our tax system works. Surveys indicate that they have no idea about how they are taxed, much less about the overall contours of federal and state tax systems. For instance, a poll found that 2/3 of Americans say they only know a little bit or nothing at all about U.S. tax policy. Half think that 75% of federal revenues comes from personal income taxes, whereas less than half of federal revenues actually comes from personal income taxes. The book focuses on U.S. tax policy, but includes information about other countries where it is enlightening. For example, we talk about U.S. tax burdens compared with the rest of the world and discuss the value-added tax, VAT, which is not currently part of the U.S. tax arsenal, but is ubiquitous elsewhere and often proposed for the United States by would-be reformers. We offer an overview of state and local taxation in the United States, but our main focus is on federal taxes. The book has three main sections. Part 1 describes how we are taxed in the United States. It starts with a broad overview and then more detailed discussion of personal and business taxes, taxes on spending, such as the VAT, and other taxes, such as the estate tax. Part 2 discusses the costs and benefits of taxation. We begin by discussing how taxes affect the economy, the trillion-plus dollars of spending that are channeled through the tax system, sometimes called the hidden welfare state, the burden of taxation and notions of fairness, how the Internal Revenue Service, IRS, runs the U.S. tax system and how complex the process is, and finally, whether taxpayers always deal with the tax system in a rational manner. Part 3, a tour of the sausage factory, covers tax politics and tax reform. Although taxes can be mind-numbing, we hope to key our discussion to issues that are likely to be on the mind of the average taxpayer and be in the news, as well as supply interesting information that many readers might not know about, such as how the IRS decides whom to audit. We have tried to employ a light touch, interjecting tax humor and political cartoons where appropriate, and illustrating key data with very simple graphics. Why did we write a second edition? Well, as we note in the book, the tax system changes. Since the first edition, Congress passed the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act of 2017, the biggest modification of the U.S. tax system since the Tax Reform Act of 1986. The policy debate that led to TCJA raised a number of important issues that weren't on anybody's radar screen in 2013. For example, the destination-based cash flow tax, DBCFT, is a mouthful. What is it? And it's made other issues that we did discuss in the first issue a lot more salient, for example, territorial taxation. In addition, the political process leading up to TCJA has revealed much more about how tax legislation gets made in the United States that is worth examining. And the run-up to the 2020 presidential election raises even more issues, such as, should the United States adopt a wealth tax? This is a major update. We have revised and updated nearly every topic in the first edition. We have added more than 40 new entries, including a new chapter on behavioral economics. We have been heartened by the reception of the first edition in terms of sales, text adoption, favorable reviews, and compliments. The second edition is even better. Part 1. How are we taxed? 1. The view from 30,000 feet. Why is everyone always so worked up about taxation? Taxes in America amount to about 30% of national income, or roughly $15,000 per man, woman, and child. That's a lot of money that could otherwise be spent on goods and services that people value and enjoy. So it's no surprise that Americans pay very close attention to whether we are getting our money's worth and whether our own tax bill is too high. Legendary Supreme Court Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes Jr. once said that, "Taxes are what we pay for civilized society." This is true in the sense that tax dollars fund the basic architecture of a free society, a court system, fire and police departments, national defense. But governments now do much more than that. They support large social insurance programs that provide income and medical care to the elderly and low-income non-elderly, as well as schools, highways, bridges, dams, national parks, public housing, and so on. Although Justice Holmes equated taxes with a price, taxes differ from prices in some essential dimensions. With most goods and services, paying more entitles you to more stuff, or better quality stuff, or both. But with one exception, that is not true of what you get from government. You can't bring your 1040 to Yosemite and demand VIP treatment because your tax bill is higher than most other Americans. You could try, but we doubt you'd get very far with the park ranger. Also, unlike other goods and services, you don't get to choose what you spend your tax liability on. This is decided through a political process, and probably no one ends up completely happy with how much and on what the government spends the money. Some want a bigger military and less aid to education, while others would prefer more spending on education and less on foreign aid, and so on. And unlike deciding whether to buy a Starbucks latte or rent a fancy condominium, you do not have a choice, evasion aside, about whether to remit taxes. The income tax is the most common point of contact between people and the government. The filing deadline of April 15th is as well known a date as April Fool's Day, and not many events bring on more stress than a tax audit. It's really no surprise that, according to public opinion polls, the Internal Revenue Service, or IRS, ranks near the bottom of American government institutions in popularity, while the Social Security Administration, or SSA, tops the list. For most Americans, the IRS cashes your checks, while the SSA sends checks out. This image persists even though the IRS disperses billions of payments related to, for example, the Earned Income Tax Credit and stimulus programs. Nonetheless, the process of calculating what is owed is often complex, time-consuming, intrusive, expensive, and ultimately mysterious. As the noted humorist Will Rogers said decades ago, "The income tax has made more liars out of the American people than golf has. Even when you make a tax form out on the level, you don't know when it's through if you are a crook or a martyr." Many taxpayers suspect they are martyrs, while others find loopholes to escape their tax liability. They're left holding the bag. Taxes can impose a substantial cost on people over and above the purchasing power they redirect to public purposes, because they can blunt the incentives to work, save, and invest, and can also attract resources into tax-favored but socially wasteful activities, such as tax-sheltered orange orchards or construction of see-through office buildings, which could be profitable in the early 80s because of tax benefits, despite a dearth of tenants. Tax policy affects the rewards or costs of nearly everything you can think of. It increases the price of cigarettes and alcohol, lowers the cost of giving to charity, may increase or reduce the reward to working, increases the cost of owning property or transferring wealth to your children, lowers the cost of home ownership, and subsidizes research and development. For this reason, tax policy is really about everything, or at least everything with an economic or financial angle. Some want to extend the reach of tax policy even further, supporting proposals for a tax on fattening or sugary foods, the fat tax, not to be confused with the flat tax. Denmark and Ireland have periodically proposed to tax cattle owners, over $300 per cow per year in Denmark's latest proposal, in an effort to reduce cow flatulence, a key source of the greenhouse gas methane. The fart tax should not be confused with the fat tax or the flat tax. Why was everyone especially worked up in 2018? Hint, a lot has changed. Everyone is especially worked up because in 2017, Congress passed the biggest overhaul of the income tax system in over 30 years. The new law nearly doubled the standard deduction, cut individual and corporate tax rates, doubled the child tax credit, limited the deduction for state and local taxes, provided a new 20% deduction for some business income, completely transformed the taxation of international income, and made numerous other smaller changes. We discuss the big changes in some detail in a later chapter. There was furious debate and rhetoric in the last half of 2017 as the president and congressional committees floated various trial balloons. Some supporters and opponents even occasionally put forward economic arguments for or against. Once the general shape of the legislation became clear, news articles offered taxpayers advice about year-end strategies to take advantage of the coming changes. Once January 1, 2018 arrived and the changes in what is known as the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act, TCJA, became the new tax law, people and businesses had to deal with it. Even though it's commonly called TCJA, that isn't its official name because of an epic act of senatorial mischief. Some decisions that made sense under the previous tax law no longer do, and some new tax avoidance strategies now become attractive. What is a tax? We might as well start at the beginning by defining our subject. A tax is a compulsory transfer of resources from the private sector to government that generally does not entitle the taxed person or entity to a quid pro quo. That's why it has to be compulsory. Tax liability, what is owed to the government, may be triggered by a wide variety of things, such as receiving income, purchasing certain goods or services, or owning property. Although the tax liability is not voluntary, the amount of any given tax that is due generally depends on voluntary choices made by people or corporations. Thus, in principle, one can legally avoid income tax by not earning any income, or have income below the taxation threshold, avoid retail sales tax by not buying anything, and avoid property tax by not owning any residential or commercial property. Of course, earning no income at all is not advisable, even though it lowers tax liability. Our point is that the amount of tax due depends on what you do and how you arrange your financial affairs. What's more, taxes are often borne by people other than those who write the check, so you may bear a burden from a tax even if you never file a return. What are the major kinds of taxes? Taxes can be classified on a number of dimensions. One important distinction is between impersonal and personal taxes. With the impersonal kind, how much tax is triggered is the same regardless of who undertakes whatever action triggers the tax. The usual retail sales tax is an impersonal tax because any consumer, not a business, more on that later, buying a $20 hammer in a state with a 5% sales tax triggers a $1 tax liability regardless of who sold it or who bought it. If Warren Buffett buys it, $1 in tax is due. And if one of us buys it, it is still $1. The impersonality certainly simplifies the tax collection process, as the retail business need not verify anything about the buyer, such as his or her income, wealth, age, marital status, and so on. On the other hand, as we'll discuss later, this aspect of a sales tax limits the extent to which tax liability can be linked to people's ability to pay, which bothers many who are concerned with the fairness of the distribution of tax burdens. A graduated income tax is a personal tax because the tax due per dollar of income earned depends on characteristics of the household. It depends on income. Higher income households are usually subject to higher tax liabilities and higher tax liabilities per dollar of income, and also may depend on other characteristics such as their marital status, charitable contributions, and medical expenses. How are taxes like ducks? What is and isn't called a tax sometimes becomes a high-stakes political game. Because of the heightened political resistance to anything called a tax, sometimes governments try to call taxes something else. The Reagan administration euphemistically referred to revenue enhancement when it proposed to raise taxes in the early 1980s. At the 1988 Republican National Convention, George H.W. Bush famously promised, "Read my lips, no new taxes." Once elected, Bush's designated budget director, Richard G. Darman, said he would recommend that President Bush reject any tax increase. At his confirmation hearing before the Senate Governmental Affairs Committee, Darman indicated that he would not hide behind semantic niceties. He would apply the duck test to determine if a proposal could be perceived as a tax increase. If it looks like a duck, walks like a duck, and quacks like a duck, then it is a duck. The distinction between a tax increase and a spending cut is not at all clear, because our income tax code includes many items that may be better characterized as spending programs that just happen to be delivered through the tax system. Indeed, one of the largest anti-poverty programs in the United States, the Earned Income Tax Credit, is delivered through the tax code. More on this later. Is cutting back on subsidies a duck? Prominent conservatives disagree on that question. In early 2011, anti-tax crusader Grover Norquist accused conservative Senator Tom Coburn, Republican of Oklahoma, of breaking his no-tax increase pledge by proposing an amendment to end a tax credit for ethanol. Norquist objected to the elimination of the credit because he viewed it as a bad tax increase, while Senator Coburn considered it to be a good spending cut. Are there hidden taxes? Some taxes are more visible or salient than others. Hidden taxes, like hidden fees, operate under the radar of at least some of those affected. Most retail stores, at least the ones we shop at, don't remind us of the sales tax until we arrive at the cash register. The tax is not included in the shelf price of the item. On many e-tailing sites, the sales tax, and often other taxes, is added only at the very end of the transaction. Some conservatives object to this because they fear that it makes consumers, who are often also voters, underestimate the cost of government and therefore soften their vigilance regarding big government. Of course, the retailers are aware of the tax because they have to remit the amount owed regardless of how visible the tax is to the consumer. This discussion helps sort out what it means when a retail store, for some reason usually a furniture store, advertises that we pay your sales tax as part of a sales promotion. The truth is that the store always must remit your sales tax, which means that their prices are higher than otherwise. The sales tax claim is just another, apparently appealing way to claim that they are offering a special low price. As always, a purchase subject to a 6% off sale or any price discount is only as attractive as the price before the discount. Hidden tax burdens are a bigger issue. The tax law specifies which person or business entity is legally obligated to remit taxes. But who must remit the tax does not pin down who ends up bearing the burden. The burden may be shifted. That burdens can be shifted is well known. Any parent knows that the burden of a school science project that is nominally the child's responsibility ends up costing the parent long hours. High parking meter charges not only increase shoppers' costs, but end up burdening local business owners through decreased sales. Shifting of tax burdens is common, and it is almost never the case that the individual or business that remits the tax is the only one who is made worse off. At first glance, taxes on the income of a corporation appear to decrease the income of its owners, the shareholders. However, ultimately, these taxes may also lead to higher prices of what the business sells, burdening consumers. They may also reduce wages, burdening workers as well. Are there ways to raise revenue other than taxes? Yes. But these days, non-tax revenue sources play a relatively small role in the U.S. tax system. Some non-tax revenue-raising schemes probably should be called taxes. Think about state-owned liquor stores that charge a markup far in excess of their costs. From the consumer's point of view, this is not much different from allowing private retailers to sell liquor subject to an excise tax. Cash-strapped cities sometimes beef up police activities to raise more revenue from fines and civil asset forfeitures, confiscating valuable assets that police claim are related to a criminal activity. One study found that in North Carolina, a 1 percentage point decline in county revenues led to a 0.38 percentage point increase in traffic tickets the following year. Increases in revenue, however, did not lead to a corresponding decline in tickets. Washington, D.C. raises about 1% of revenue from speed cameras, which effectively levy a tax in exchange for the privilege of exceeding the speed limit. Unlike a speeding ticket, there are no civil or criminal consequences other than the fine if it is paid on time. Critics have pointed out that these levies and forfeitures are especially burdensome for low-income residents. There are also important ways for governments to get control over resources that don't involve raising money directly. Take the military draft. Until 1973, the United States required, and nearly 100 countries still do require, that many citizens of a certain age serve in the military. A military draft has many of the features of a tax. It is compulsory, and there is no quid pro quo, aside from a usually minimal salary. Just like a tax, many draftees would prefer not to bear the burden of service. Centuries ago, it was common for governments to require compulsory labor service for other purposes. In Egypt, the use of forced labor on public works projects was used from the time of the pyramids until the mid-1800s. Forced labor was common in medieval Europe, when peasants were required to work for feudal lords, and it even occurred in the U.S. colonies. The federal government could get resources by printing money and buying things with it, an option that is not available to state or municipal governments. Compared to, say, a personal income tax, this practice, called seigniorage, obscures who bears the burden, but there is a burden nevertheless. Printing money causes inflation, which erodes the value of dollar-dominated assets such as government bonds or cash. Thus, the government gets resources at the expense of those who hold these assets. People understand this, and so when future inflation looks likely, people will not voluntarily lend to the government unless they are compensated with higher interest rates. Sometimes governments require financial institutions to hold public bonds at below market interest rates, a practice called financial repression, which is another way to effectively obtain wealth from the private sector. The United States does not typically print money to fund a substantial fraction of its operations. But in the past century, several countries in desperate fiscal situations have resorted to the printing press, causing hyperinflation and disastrous consequences for the economy. Between 1914 and 1923, the Weimar Republic of Germany saw its price level increase by the mind-boggling factor of 1 trillion. The printing presses ran all night and issued notes of larger and larger denomination, while workers immediately purchased goods with their paychecks as the currency depreciated by the minute. In the spring of 2006, the New York Times reported that in hyperinflating Zimbabwe, toilet paper cost 417 Zimbabwean dollars, not per roll, but per single two-ply sheet. A roll cost $145,750, and Zimbabwe printed $100 trillion banknotes. Why not just borrow the money instead of raising taxes? The federal government can borrow money to fund its operations, and in recent years has been doing this to an unprecedented degree. But borrowing is fundamentally different from raising money through tax or tax-like means. For one thing, No one coerces anyone to lend to the government. They do so voluntarily because they find the interest rate attractive given the minimal default risk. Thus, government borrowing does not eliminate or even reduce the burden of government spending, but rather just postpones the reckoning of this burden, which will be felt through some combination of higher taxes in the future and cutbacks in government spending or the inflation tax just discussed. How can taxes be like regulations? In most cases, taxes are designed to raise revenue, and the changes in behavior they induce are unintended, undesirable byproducts. No policymaker intends to deter an automaker from building a plant in Michigan, but the corporate income tax may do that. Likewise, most politicians do not want to discourage spouses from entering or staying in the workforce, but the individual income tax can do that. Some taxes, though, are intended to change behavior. One reason for taxing gasoline is to induce people to use less energy. Carbon taxes are designed to reduce emission of greenhouse gases that scientists believe contribute to global warming. Instead of using tax policy to achieve those aims, one can imagine regulations that restrict, limit, or proscribe the activities. For example, a cap-and-trade system can have effects similar to a carbon tax. Under this system, the government sets a limit on total emissions and then allocates or auctions a number of permits equal to that amount. The permits can then be bought and sold, which establishes a market price. This market price has the same effect as a tax, making the polluting activity more costly. If the explicit tax or the implicit tax due to the market price of the permits is equal to the social cost of the polluting activity, then decision makers are induced to take heed of the social cost of their actions. How can regulations and spending programs be like taxes? Some regulations have tax-like consequences because they affect prices, incomes, and behavior. For example, environmental and safety regulations add to the price of automobiles, and eligibility rules for spending programs can effectively increase or decrease households' spendable income. Eligibility for cash assistance programs is tied to income. A single parent with two young children working full-time earning $8 per hour would have qualified for $87 per month in Temporary Assistance for Needy Families, TANF, and $370 in Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program SNAP benefits in the District of Columbia in 2012. If her wage increased by $1 per hour, her gross income would increase by $173 per month, but she'd lose $58 in TANF and $25 in SNAP benefits, a total of $83 per month. Thus, almost half of her pay increase would be offset by benefit cuts, equivalent to an effective tax rate of 48%. She'd also lose $28 in earned income tax credits and owe $10 in payroll taxes on the additional income. In total, the extra $173 in income would cost her $121 in lost benefits and increased taxes, an implicit tax rate of 70%, 121 divided by 173. High-income households can also face substantial implicit taxes attributable to spending programs. For example, individuals aged 65 and over pay income-tested premiums for Medicare Part B medical insurance. In 2018, annual premiums totaled $1,608 for single people with income of $85,000 or less, $2,250 for incomes between $85,000 and $107,000, and more at higher incomes. A Medicare recipient whose income rose from $85,000 to $86,000 would owe $642 in additional Medicare premiums for an implicit tax rate of 64.2%. At higher income thresholds, the effective tax rate can be as high as 96.5% for a $1,000 increase in income. Including the effect of Part D, prescription drugs, which is also means-tested at the same thresholds, the implicit tax rate can be over 120%. There is one important difference between the implicit taxes created by spending programs and explicit taxes embodied in the Internal Revenue Code. Participation in spending programs is voluntary, whereas taxes are compulsory. But for people who choose to participate in the government programs, more than 90% of eligible people participate in Medicare Part B, the effects of the implicit taxes on economic incentives and family budgets are the same as under an explicit tax. How have taxes changed over time? Beginning about a century ago, the role of government began to expand all over the world, and the United States was no exception. Before World War I, taxes levied by all levels of government comprised less than 3% of national income. Now they are over 25%. So, as a share of the economy, taxes are about 10 times as high as they were in 1912. But nearly all of that phenomenal growth occurred from 1912 to 1962. Since that time, federal taxes as a percentage of national income have gone up and down quite a lot, but have not trended upward or downward, while state and local taxes have drifted upward. How do state and local taxes vary? The Tax Foundation calculated for each state taxes paid, including fees, to state and local governments as a percentage of income in 2012. The ratio varies from a maximum of 12.7% in New York to a low of 6.5% in Alaska. More than three-quarters of the state's tax ratios lie between 7.6% and 10.9%. How does the composition of tax vary across federal, state, and local governments? The federal government's revenue comes predominantly from individual income taxes, 47.9% in 2017, and social insurance and retirement receipts, 35%, while only 9% comes from corporate income taxes, 2.5% from excise taxes, and 0.7% from estate and gift taxes. In contrast, excluding intergovernmental grants and fees and charges, state and local governments get about two-thirds of their tax revenue from sources hardly used at all by the federal government, 34.8% from sales taxes and 31.1% from property taxes, while only 23.5% of their tax revenue derived from the individual income tax in 2015, figure 1.1. Is the United States really the highest taxed country in the world? President Donald Trump liked to say at campaign rallies that the United States is the highest taxed country in the world. In fact, compared to other rich countries, we are a low tax country. In 2016, our average federal, state, and local tax burdens amounted to 26% of GDP, well below the OECD average of 34.3%. See figure 1.2. The ratio of taxes to national output varied from 45.9% in Denmark to 17.2% in Mexico. And our tax burden is even lower after the 2017 passage of the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act. Closer examination reveals that, among developed countries, the United States raises about the average share of GDP from income taxes. What sets us apart from other developed economies is how little we collect from consumption taxes, such as retail sales taxes or excise taxes, where the total tax is determined by the amount of spending, not income or wealth. Most other countries in the world raise a substantial share of revenue from a type of consumption tax that is called a value-added tax, or VAT, which the United States does not have. In those countries with higher taxes, governments provide services we have to pay for out of our own pockets here. Free health care is the developed world norm. Heavily subsidized child care is common. Generous childbearing and child-raising benefits are usually provided, and unemployment benefits are high and long-lasting. Federal taxes in the United States have been at about 18% of GDP for 50 years. Does that mean that this is the natural rate of taxation? Not in any meaningful economic sense. Economies can thrive with much different levels of tax, but 18% may represent a sort of political equilibrium that reflects the level of private consumption Americans have been willing to give up for what the federal government provides. When revenues have risen significantly above the historical norm, policymakers have chosen to cut taxes. Why is the long-term fiscal outlook so dire? Critics complained that the TCJA reduced revenues by almost $2 trillion over its first decade, which they viewed as especially irresponsible in light of the government's deteriorating fiscal situation. There is a huge mismatch between the promises we have made regarding Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid benefits and the taxes we have in place to fund them. The so-called entitlement programs are projected to grow much faster than the economy and tax revenues because, one, Americans are living longer so that the ratio of benefit recipients to working taxpaying Americans is rising, and, two, healthcare costs continue to grow faster than other prices. Medicare pays for acute care for the elderly, and Medicaid pays for about half of nursing home care. By one reputable calculation, the gap between promised Social Security and Medicare benefits and the taxes, fees, and premiums that fund them amounts to over $53 trillion. Yes, trillion, over the next 75 years. Given this mismatch, benefits will need to be cut, taxes increased, or both. Can taxes be discussed without getting into government spending? In the rest of this book, we will try our best to focus on the tax side of government budgets. But inevitably, at several points along the way, we will have to talk about spending. One reason is that, as already mentioned, sometimes the distinction between taxing less and spending more, or between taxing more and spending less, is arbitrary, reflecting semantic distinctions that are inconsequential from an economics perspective. Sometimes these inconsequential distinctions are reflected in official government accounting, so that of two programs that are effectively the same, one looks to be a tax cut and the other a spending increase. Later, we will address the notion of tax expenditures, which are spending programs embedded within the income tax system. The appropriate level of taxes should reflect a comparison of the benefits of what government spending provides, be it national security, social insurance, fire departments, or national parks, with the cost of taxes. When comparing the benefits to the costs, we need to bear in mind that the cost of taxes should also reflect the disincentives and misallocations that taxes inevitably cause. For this reason, a bridge that costs $500 million to build should promise benefits quite a bit higher than that. The link between what government provides and what it collects shows up repeatedly in public opinion polls. 45% of Americans say that the amount of tax they pay is too high, according to a 2018 Gallup poll, and only 3% say it is too low. But when asked whether the federal government should spend more, less, or the same on Social Security, Medicare, education, or defense, the anti-tax sentiment dims. More than 8 in 10 oppose cuts in these programs. This pattern of answers does not dispose of the issues, because one should inquire into how much such programs would have to be cut back. But pairing the tax question and the spending question is the right way to think about fiscal issues. Spending without taxing does not provide free services, but the underlying benefit-cost analysis gets blurred because the federal government can borrow. When it does, the immediate visible signal of the cost of government, taxes due, understates the true cost of government spending. The cost of government is measured much more accurately by what it spends than by what it collects in taxes. Thus, a claim that taxes are too high is either a statement that, 1, the government should just borrow more, or 2, the government spends too much. The first is often bad economics or wishful thinking, because borrowing does not lower the cost of government, and in most cases increases it by directing private spending into government bonds rather than productive capital. As to the second, we should always inquire exactly what government programs should be axed or slimmed down. Many Americans care little about the abstract question of whether overall taxes are too high, too low, or just about right. They care much more about their taxes and their own tax liability. And that's a whole different matter, because whether my tax burden is $25,000 a year or $50,000 a year has absolutely no effect on the strength of our national defense, the viability of the Medicare system, or whether the local park is well manicured. At the macro level, determining the right allocation of tax burdens depends on resolving what is fair, always a contentious issue, and how alternative tax systems that assign tax burdens affect economic growth. We will do our best to answer these and other questions in the rest of this book. 2. Personal income taxes. What's the difference between personal taxes and business taxes? Some taxes are levied on people, and some are levied on businesses. This distinction is less important than you might think. The fact is, the person or business entity that writes the check doesn't necessarily bear the burden of the tax. Consider the corporate income tax. Many people like the corporate income tax because they think businesses should pay taxes, not people. But the fact that the business remits the tax doesn't really tell you whose bottom line is affected by it. It could be the company's shareholders. It could be the workers. The tax could be passed through to consumers in the form of higher prices, or it could be some combination of all of those. The fact that the corporation pays the tax doesn't tell you much. In fact, we avoid using the term pays tax because it is uninformative. It could mean one of two things: who writes the check, i.e. remits the tax, or who bears the burden of a tax. Most people know what the individual income tax is. It's the tax that has made April 15th as iconic as the Super Bowl, without the parties or the popcorn. It's probably the most salient tax for most people, even though these days most people owe more in payroll taxes than income taxes. The federal payroll tax is earmarked to fund Social Security retirement, survivors, and disability insurance, as well as Medicare. Sometimes it's called the FICA tax, after the legislation that enacted it, the Federal Insurance Contributions Act. For self-employed people, it's called the SECA tax, the Self-Employment Contributions Act. We have no idea why there are two names for basically the same tax, but it's a fun fact that will impress your friends at cocktail parties. Sales taxes and property taxes are mostly collected by state and local governments. Indeed, those are two of the three most important taxes collected at that level. Most states also levy income taxes. Taxes nominally leveled on businesses include federal and state corporate taxes, a portion of payroll taxes, including taxes administered by state governments to cover unemployment and disability insurance, and excise taxes. businesses also remit the value-added tax, VAT, which is common throughout the world, but is not levied in the United States. The VAT is a kind of sales tax. Some taxes are remitted by other entities. For example, the estate tax is remitted by the fiduciary of the estate of somebody who has died, typically somebody fairly wealthy. Fiduciaries of trusts also remit taxes. Those are effectively personal taxes, but the entity that writes the check is the trust that manages the assets, not the person on whose behalf the trust is administered. And nonprofit organizations may have to remit tax if they engage in certain profit-making activities. But as a practical matter, these distinctions are not particularly important because, as noted, who writes the check may have very little effect on who actually bears the burden of the tax. Who really bears the burden of tax? The answer is often more complicated than you might think. Let's get back to the example of the corporate income tax. As we've discussed, somebody bears the burden of the tax, but it's not obvious who. For a long time, the conventional wisdom among economists was that owners of capital, and not just owners of corporations, bore the tax burden because it pushed business activity into non-corporate activities, driving down the rate of return. But more recent research suggests that workers bear part of the tax burden because their wages are lower than they would be if the corporate tax weren't imposed. This could have a big effect on people's assessment of the tax. If you think the tax translates into lower wages, you might be less enthusiastic about it than if relatively rich shareholders are worse off because of it. We'll talk more about this later. Sidebar 2.1. Taxing the rich and jobs. President Obama proposed raising income tax rates on couples making over $250,000 per year and singles making over $200,000. This is roughly the top 2% of households. The president argued that he was just asking the well-off to pay their fair share. Critics countered that such a tax would hurt workers because a lot of the top 2% are entrepreneurs who would cut jobs if their income tax went up. In other words, the critics were arguing that a significant part of the incidence of the millionaire's tax would fall on labor, ordinary folk. Let's take another example, the payroll tax. Half of FICA taxes are levied on employers and half on employees. What does that mean? For almost all employees, both halves are remitted by their employer to the government. Would it make much difference if we called it all an employer tax or all an employee tax? No. Employers decide to hire workers based on what it costs to employ them. They don't really care whether the cost comes in the form of wages or payroll taxes, or for that matter, health insurance. All that matters is the total compensation cost, including taxes and fringe benefits. So, if employers' payroll taxes fell, they would be willing to pay higher wages. If payroll taxes increased, they would cut cash wages. Probably not instantaneously, because workers think wage cuts are unfair and that can hurt morale, but wage increases would be slower than they would otherwise be until compensation was back in line with worker productivity. Although it's conceivable that consumers or capital owners could bear all or part of the tax burden, statistical studies have almost uniformly concluded that workers bear the entire burden of both the employer and employee portions of the payroll tax. The economic incidence of other taxes is less clear. For example, it's commonly assumed that households bear the cost of the individual income tax. But there's little reason to think that this is so, especially when the individual income tax has all sorts of credits and deductions intended to subsidize particular activities. For example, one tax credit is designed to encourage purchase of fuel-efficient hybrid vehicles. The extra demand, due to the subsidized price, almost surely pushes up the price of such cars. This might be a good thing if the purpose is to encourage more car makers to produce green vehicles, but it means that part of the benefit of the tax credit goes to producers, not consumers. There are, however, no good empirical estimates of how much of the individual income tax is borne by households and how much by others. The bottom line is this: the person who ends up bearing the tax may be very different from the person or entity that writes the check to the government, or the person or business entity that the tax law proclaims the tax is on. Are there cases in practice where it does matter who writes the check? Yes. For one thing, who writes the check can matter most when not everyone is scrupulously honest. For example, the IRS collects a much, much larger share of what is owed from withholding taxes remitted by employers than from income tax owed by self-employed people, even though the formula for calculating liability is exactly the same. If your employer is responsible for remitting the tax, it usually makes it to the IRS. If you have to self-report, on average, you're much less likely to send in all of what you owe. Another example is sales and use taxes. If you live in a state with a sales tax, you owe the tax whether you buy something at the corner store or order it over the internet from an out-of-state merchant. The store owner remits the tax in the first case, whereas the purchaser often has to remit a use tax in the second. Do you send in all the use tax you owe on your internet purchases? If so, you're in very exclusive company. The entity that writes the check matters. We'll talk more about this in the chapter about compliance and enforcement. Can taxes affect asset prices? Yes. A tax on the return an asset provides generally reduces its value, while a subsidy increases its value. This effect, known as capitalization of the tax into the asset's value, is more likely to occur in cases where the total supply of the asset is not easily adjusted. The tax change can produce a penalty or a windfall for current asset owners, but it has little or no effect on the affordability for future buyers. An important example of capitalization that troubles some economists, including us, is the mortgage interest deduction. Many middle-class homeowners think of this as their big tax break. If they itemize their deductions, they get to deduct some or all of the interest from taxable income, and it's one of the biggest tax breaks in the code. But suppose it makes people want to live on bigger properties. In places where land is scarce, that would just bid up land prices because you can't make more land. And so some of the tax break is dissipated in higher property prices. This is a boon to property owners at the time the tax break is enacted or expanded, but means that the average new homeowner may not benefit much. People in top brackets who get the biggest tax breaks probably come out ahead. People with lower incomes, who, because they don't itemize deductions or are in a low tax bracket, might get little or no benefit from the deduction, might be worse off than they would be if mortgage interest wasn't deductible. And if it also pushes up the market price of rental housing because land is more expensive, renters are unambiguously worse off. What is the personal income tax? Pretty simple. It's a tax on individual income collected by the federal government and most states. The federal tax is progressive, which means the tax rate rises with income. More on this later. Defining income, however, is not as straightforward as you might think. The standard economist's definition of income is the sum of what you spend and what you save. Spending is straightforward, but measuring saving is more complicated. It includes what we put in the bank, mutual funds, retirement accounts, and other kinds of investments. But increases in wealth that we don't spend also add to savings and hence to income. In many cases, this unfamiliar definition lines up with the more familiar meaning. What you are paid if you are employed, plus what you make from owning a business, and from investments. But in some cases, that we'll expand on later, it differs in important ways. The income tax is much more than a tax on income. While some deductions account for the cost of earning income, for example, prior to passage of the TCJA, you could deduct the cost of uniforms that you had to wear to work, many deductions, exemptions, and tax credits are intended to provide subsidies of some sort or another. They often have little to do with the measurement of income. Isn't the income tax a fraud? Some tax protesters argue that the 16th Amendment to the Constitution, which authorized the personal income tax in 1913, was improperly ratified or otherwise invalid. You can find many of these people in jail. Courts have repeatedly concluded that the income tax is indeed constitutional and excoriated those who question its validity as frivolous, ridiculous, or worse. You may not like the income tax, but it is legal and valid.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.